Are you with me? And the vibrato is often a way to dramatize a real dramatic situation. There are a variety of reasons. But I think for all of these reasons, we recognize some differences between Broadway musicals and opera. But here's the deal. There are some Broadway musicals that require someone to have a little bit of opera singing training. You may not know anything about Broadway musicals, but there are musicals, well, for example, Les Miserables, right? Or even some stuff by Rodgers and Hammerstein where soprano voices have to go up high in a dramatic moment. Now, usually they don't hire someone with a big, thick voice with a lot of vibrato, like in grand opera. But they won't hire someone who's just, who's singing in a more popular music style either. They'll hire someone sort of in between. Are you with me? And there are terms like operetta to imply either a lighter opera or a shorter opera. Because there are some works that sound a little bit like Broadway musicals at times and sound a little bit like opera at times in the same work. And that's where we get into this portion of the semester. Because a lot of American opera in the 20th century mixes singing styles so that at one moment you might be listening to something that sounds like traditional opera, and another moment you might be hearing something that sounds like a song right out of a Broadway show in the same work. Are you with me? And that's going to be something that's very significant when we discuss 20th century. Now there's one more issue before we start talking about our first composer. And the other is the issue of classical music versus popular music. You know, terms like these are often imprecise at best. They're generalizations. You know, we talked about Charles Ives and we talked about people like George Antheil and Ballet Mécanique, and we talked about a whole variety of pieces under the umbrella of classical music or art music. But then we also played pieces by George Gershwin, remember the three piano preludes, where even though calling them preludes was his attempt at trying to write in a classical genre. As we know, there was a lot of blues in the second prelude, and there were some jazzy rhythms in the other preludes. And we mentioned that composers often took the popular music of their times and incorporated elements from this popular music and put it into these works, so-called classical works. Are you with me? That's a generalization. Well, what happens in 20th century American opera a lot of the time is we are going to definitely hear stuff that we can identify as popular. Gee, that sounded like a Broadway song. Wow, that sounds bluesy in the orchestra. Wow, that sounded jazzy in the orchestra. Or something we haven't talked about, that sounds like ragtime music. We're going to talk about that in a minute. Or in an opera called The Life and Times of Malcolm X, gee, this sounds like there's some hip-hop and rap rhythms going on in this opera by a really superb composer by the name of Anthony Davis, African-American, so-called classical composer. So we get all of this stuff mixed together. And that's why you might be pleasantly surprised when you hear some of this stuff. If you don't like opera, and you're expecting to hear all traditional sounding opera, you're going to hear a mix of ingredients. Does that make sense, guys? Comments? Questions? Well then, why don't we get started then and talk about the handout I gave you, and the operas we're going to discuss. This is the second of the third portion of the semester. This is going to be the shortest portion of the semester, and this is going to be perhaps the easiest of the tests you'll have. The first test, the one you took today, is sort of in the middle, and then when we get to jazz at the end of the semester, that'll be a little bit more work to do for that. So what's going to happen is we're not going to talk about every single opera here, but we are going to start with a African-American composer, you might know his name, Scott Joplin, who wrote ragtime pieces. How many of you heard this? Piece written by Scott Joplin. Ragtime was a style that preceded, that came before jazz. In fact, a lot of people theorize that ragtime music mixed with blues are the two main ingredients that led to the beginning of jazz. Now, that's an oversimplification. There are other things that go into it, but ragtime and blues together really helped lead to the beginnings of jazz. What was the deal about ragtime? It was syncopated music. Did we talk about syncopation in the beginning of the semester? Yes, sort of. Anybody want to take a stab at what syncopation is? Remember we talked about, we drew, for example, 1, 2, 3, 4. If we group together a piece of music into groups of 4 beats, and we said in traditional Western European and American European music, you'd often have an accent on the 1, and maybe a little accent on the 3 beat. So you'd have 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Should we try it? Ready? And 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. Great. We're ready for Carnegie Hall. I'll book it tomorrow. That is basically, this is again a generalization, but that is basically how European music developed, was you'd either organize beats in music into groups of 4, or in groups of 3, where you'd still have an accent on the 1, or in groups of 2, where you'd still have an accent on the 1. That's called the downbeat. 1, 2, 1, 2, or 1, 2, 3, 4, or 1, 2, 3. Are you with me? So that's called an accents on the downbeats. If you accent in other spots, other than those places, that's called syncopation. So let's say, for example, let's take this half of the class, and you guys will clap as you did before. 1, 2, 3, 4, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. And I want you guys to clap 1, 2, 3, and do a really strong accent on the 4. And that's not up there. There isn't an accent on the 4 in traditional European music in general. So I'd like you guys to really do a very strong accent on the 4. Are you with me? And you guys don't do that. Just do the 1, 2, 3, 4. So why don't you guys get started? Ready? And 1, 2, 3. Keep going. Ready? 1, 2, 3. You hear that little jarring accent that makes it a little bit more interesting, a little bit more exciting? That's called syncopation. Now, it can either be an accent on the 4 beat, it can be an accent on the 2 beat, or it it can even be an accent in between the beats. For example, if we have you guys clap the 1, 2, 3, 4 again, and you guys just clap one clap very strongly in between the 2 and 3 beats. So you're gonna go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, you with me? You understand? So you're just gonna do one clap in between the 2 and 3 beats. You guys start with your regular clapping of 4 beats. Ready? And 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, ready? 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Great, thank you. That's syncopation also. Now, to us in our ears in, 2014, we think, big deal. We've had 100 years of jazz that's syncopated, we've had rock and roll that's syncopated, we've had rap and hip-hop that's syncopated, we've had, all kinds of music that's syncopated for 100 years. But it wasn't until around the 1850s or 60s in America where we started to have syncopated music across the country. And that was because of some European-American people that heard African-American slaves on plantations singing and clapping these syncopated rhythms. And some of these European-Americans were saying, wow, this is interesting stuff. Unfortunately, a lot of this syncopated music came to white America initially in what we call minstrel shows. Did we talk about that at all? Remember minstrel shows? They were originally comical shows on stage where white people painted themselves in blackface and caricatured and made fun of what they thought were characteristics of African American culture. They were racist shows. But they were singing syncopated songs, and some of these troupes would tour America, and people would start to hear syncopated music. Are you with me? That eventually developed into ragtime music. Because here's the syncopation. That's the syncopated moment. Without the syncopation, it would sound like this. It loses that rhythmic excitement, doesn't it? What does it sound like now? Anybody ever been in the military? What does it sound like? What do you do in the military? March. It's really a march. In fact, the left-handed piano playing really does a march-like rhythm. It's the right hand that syncopates. There's another ragtime piece. It's march. And it's the da-da, da-da. It's almost like there are two notes, da-da, where the first note is very quick and the second one is held longer. Short, long, short, long, short, long, short, long. Are you with me? That's it. That's what makes up ragtime, really, are those two notes that are syncopated. Are you with me? And that's what happens on the piano.